Right, thank you all for coming. This is a Politics Now Society event, which is in conversation with. So we'll have MPs, lecturers, politicians come in and discuss their lives, how they got into politics, and what is the factors that they want to continue to make a difference in British politics and help people change lives. Norman, thank you for coming. With yesterday, and obviously the sad news that people lost their lives and what we were looking into, do you think that Britain should, and the world should, stand together and fight these people who threaten to hurt us and the democracy and freedom of every British core value that we hold?
Yeah, I think it's quite important to be defiant at a time like this. I was in the statement for the Prime Minister this morning, and I thought actually she did it very well. I thought it was she spoke, I think, effectively on behalf of the whole nation, and everyone in Parliament was in a state of shock yesterday. It's you know, I guess it's one of those situations where none of us really believe that we're going to get caught up in a terrorist incident, and then when it happens, it's pretty shocking. And I just walked past the place where the shooting took place, and the car crashed into the railings just below my office. I'm in Portcullis House on the third floor, and someone who was waiting to see me in my office witnessed everything happening from my office window. So quite traumatizing for a lot of people, and I was just walking back from the chamber to my office, and suddenly there was this surge of people behind us just shouting, "Get out, get out, get out, police are telling us get out," and inevitably people panic a bit, and there's a sort of a bit of a stampede to get out. There's an underground exit into the tube station, and we got to the exit, and it's two revolving doors, but you have to press a button to get the door to unlock, and so there was a sort of logjam with people desperate to get out. And at that moment, you don't know whether there's someone, you know, coming down behind you with a gun. We had no idea what the incident was at all. So there were several people getting quite stressed, and we got out and ended up in New Scotland Yard in the police headquarters. They looked after us very well. But I think the sort of message that one sort of dreadfully misdirected idiot behaving as he did yesterday cannot undermine the values that we hold, our values in democracy, in pluralism, and the importance of, I think at this stage, sort of demonstrating solidarity across the different communities in our country. Because the real danger when this sort of thing happens is that people can very easily turn on communities. There was one MP actually, it's actually a Conservative MP, who made the point that this is not Islamic terrorism, because that sort of gives an indication that Islam represents this sort of behavior, and then it puts all Muslim communities in a way at risk. And he made the point that it's no more representing Islam than the people who killed Ari Neve, the Conservative minister, back in the, when was it, the 70s, the 80s, the 70s, the IRA attack on Ari Neve. Well, you know, that was a Catholic doing that attack, but of course it didn't represent Christianity in any way, and so we've got to isolate these extremists and treat them for what they are, not in any way representing a community or a religion, it seems to me.
Shall I show you a frustration? With the mass media, always, or more than likely, putting, even when the that tango hasn't been identified before in a certain way, fails to put Islamic or fails to put connotations with Muslims and Islam. Do you think that this is a kind of anti way of trying to solve the problem? So if they keep giving you know, a sort of discourse that Muslims are all terrorists, then it's just creating more political and community unrest.
Well, I don't know what the intention is with everyone who writes that, but I just think that all mainstream politicians from across the political spectrum and members of the public need to just resist that. Because if you're a Muslim family in Nottingham here, a law-abiding Muslim family, you will probably at this moment be quite anxious about the potential implications for your family, the safety of your children. Will they get abused? Will they get violence, aggression on the streets and so forth? And we've got to demonstrate to those people that we stand with them and seek, as I say, to isolate the individuals who behave like this, and indeed the people who preach hatred and radicalise young people in this way.
Moving on to mental health.
Yep.
Students. A lot of students, myself, suffer from mental health.
Yep.
I think the statistics with 1 in 4 students will have some form of mental health illness during a university phase. What do you think can or could be done to help students, either by the NHS, by the university, or by the just wider community?
Well, this is my sort of passion, really, the issue of mental health, and it's born out of both a sort of professional interest that I developed doing my job as a shadow health spokesperson for the Lib Dems, and then subsequently as a minister in the coalition government, but also out of family experience. And it's worth just sort of quickly declaring that interest. Our oldest son, Archie, is now 29, working now very successfully in the music business. But he was diagnosed with obsessive compulsive disorder at the age of 15 or 16. I don't know whether any of you are familiar with that condition. It's often trivialized. You know, people say, oh, I'm a bit OCD, meaning that they're a bit orderly, or they might go through sort of trivial rituals before leaving the house or whatever. OCD in its true form is a really punishing condition. You have dark thoughts, really dark thoughts, that and it may be that, you know, I could kill my mother or something deeply offensive to the individual, which is often the furthest from the truth. I mean, it's a completely irrational fear of what you might do, but you can't escape from it. It lodges in your brain. And the only way you get to deal with it is by going through rituals. If I do this, this, and this, the awful thing that I'm fearing won't happen. And so you then become trapped into doing rituals. I did a joint interview with Archie recently for a website where people tell their stories about mental ill health. And he talked about how at a certain stage, when he was about 17 or 18, he struggled even to walk down the street on his own, because he would see sharp objects on the ground which he felt could injure someone, and he totally irrationally feared that he might have been responsible if he didn't remove it. So he would be stopping and picking up things constantly and literally not able to make progress down the street. And of course, you then become very angry with yourself and with your situation. I remember the moment when he said to me, Dad, why am I the only person who's going mad? And you think about all that a teenager is trying to sort of cope with as they're growing up. And you think about trying to deal with that as well at the same time. And all of the experience that Archie had is just repeated loads of times all over the country. And there may well be many people in this room who have their own experiences, either themselves or with a sibling. And the truth is that we still fail to deal properly with mental ill health. If any of you experience mental health issues as a child or as a teenager, the common experience is that you're left waiting months on end after a referral by your GP, waiting for something to happen. And that's our experience. We were let down by the NHS. We were told at one point when he was about 18, and we were pretty desperate at that point, it was a pretty bad situation. And we were told that it would be up to 6 months before he could start his treatment. And we were desperate to get that started. So what do you do as a family in that situation? Well, you do what you can, and the brutal truth is we paid for treatment for him. But does anyone in this room want to sort of tolerate a society where people with money can get access to treatment and people who don't have money are left waiting, sometimes interminably? And 75% of young people with mental ill health problems get no treatment at all. So it's a hopeless failure, and it's a real injustice, because in the last decade, it was the Labour government at that time. I don't make a particular political point here, because I think it was just about the point in time of the development of our understanding of mental health. But the Labour government introduced, and they were right to do so, maximum waiting times within the NHS for, you know, waiting for an operation, waiting for cancer treatment, waiting in an A&E department, and so on. But they didn't introduce maximum waiting times in mental health. So you create a sort of inbuilt discrimination, really, at the heart of our NHS against people who suffer from mental ill health. And it was worse than that, because they also introduced something called payment by results. It, basically, the idea is that hospitals get paid for treatment. So every time someone goes for a cancer treatment or for an operation for a leg or a hip or whatever, the hospital gets paid. It's actually payment for activity. So the more that people were channeled through acute hospitals to get treatment, to meet those very politically resonant maximum waiting times, hospitals just kept getting more and more money. But without the same incentives with mental health, it just lost out in terms of the finances. More and more money went into acute hospitals. Something had to give, and it was mental health. And so, as minister, I introduced maximum waiting time standards in two areas: access to psychological therapies and access to treatment when you suffer the first episode of psychosis. But there are very, very many other disease areas within mental health, and indeed children's mental health, where we're still waiting. And the government says that they are committed to doing it, but they give no money to it. So we just keep waiting for something to happen. And this is where I get frustrated with the government, because the Prime Minister, quite powerfully, when she was first made Prime Minister, talked about the burning injustices in society. That's the description she gave. And she particularly highlighted people with mental ill health. But it seems to me that if you're honest enough to identify injustices in society as a politician, you've then got to have a policy response to meet that injustice. You can't just say it's an injustice and do nothing about it. But that's the situation at the moment. There's a massive gap between the rhetoric, which is good, government ministers talking positively about mental health and the need to provide better support, and the reality, where the investment still isn't being made, and the injustice for very many families around our country continues. Sorry, my answers are a bit long. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Obviously, Conservative government trying to not fight the funding gap on mental health with such as prisons trying to be a holding cell for people with mental illness.
Well, 119 people last year took their own lives through suicide in our prisons. Now, you know, people have committed crimes, and they sometimes they need to go into prison if they're a danger to the public. I happen to believe that we imprison far too many people. and that it doesn't protect the public because they go out and reoffend. But the state also has a responsibility to those people in their care, and for 119 people to lose their lives, I think it's shameful. And very many of those people will be suffering from mental ill health or a learning disability or autism, and they shouldn't be in prison in the first place, many of them.
Do you think that, with also the financial aspect, that non-drug means of mental health and mental health recognition through, as you said, children all the way up to adults,
yeah,
that needs to be improved, and mental health is becoming the norm now, with obviously celebrities, politicians such as yourself, talking about it and actually bringing it into the teenage and student and young people rhetoric,
yeah,
which then should then filter up to the older people.
Yeah. I do think that there's historically there's been a massive stigma about mental health, and if you just go back 10 years, it was really the hidden illness. No one talked about it, and you know, families felt embarrassed to talk about it. Some, we have to remember, still do. And there are very many people still who fear that if they admit to their mental ill health, that it will damage their career, they'll lose their job, or they won't get the promotion that they're after. And so they sort of suffer in silence, which just makes their whole situation worse. And it was that situation with Archie. He said to me, I want to talk about openly about my mental health problems, but I fear that it will affect me in the music business. We got to a point, I mean, it was a particularly unpleasant point, because there was a Sunday paper sought to expose the fact that he had taken drugs. There's a very important point to make here, that very many people with mental ill health sort of self-medicate through taking alcohol or drugs, because it's a sort of escape from the pain that they may be suffering. And someone was trying to blackmail him, and it's awful, because the only reason it was of interest to the press was because he was my son, our son, and that was of interest to the press because at the time I was a minister in the government. And so it was very unfair on him, but as it turns out, it happened to be a cathartic moment, because I said to him, when we were faced with, on the Saturday, with the Sunday Mirror proposing to run a story on it, which ended up as a splash across their front page, I said to him, I think now's the moment when you talk about it. And he agreed, and he and I both talked about it, and we've subsequently been on ITN National News and on BBC Breakfast talking about it.
For mental health campaigner Norman Lamb, politics is personal, driven by the suffering of the son by his side and his long battle with depression.
It just takes over your head, basically. It just, you can't think of anything else. And when you get into depression, you cannot think of anything else apart from the gloom of how you're feeling. In my toughest moments, you don't feel like there's any escape.
In your worst times, did you feel like taking your own life? Did you feel suicidal?
I've had those thoughts ever since I can remember. I mean, they're not very nice thoughts to have, obviously. It's really, really horrible, and you'd feel embarrassed to talk about them. At the time I wouldn't have spoken to my parents about it, because, or my friends, because it's embarrassing.
Did you feel alone in trying to deal with this? Did you think there was no one out there,
yes,
in the NHS to help you?
Yes, definitely.
Well, I remember the moment when he said, why am I the only person who's going mad? And you just think, how tough is that for a teenager to have that feeling that you're the only one? And of course, you're not. There are so many people who experience this, but...
And suffer in silence.
Suffer in silence.
What toll did it take on your family?
Well, we've been through emotional turmoil for 12 years now. There have been incredibly difficult times. I mean, there have been times in London when I've had to leave the hotel where I stay when I'm down here to go across to see Archie at a moment of crisis late at night, near midnight. And you have no idea what you're going to find. And it's really scary. And then when you need the NHS at that moment of crisis and it's not there, it's dire. The brutal truth is that as a family, we could afford to get help for him when there wasn't help available on the NHS because we couldn't wait that long. But there are so many families who can't do that.
That's a scary thing.
It's not an option.
If they're going through like the darkest depression, yeah, and they could, you know, they could be thinking of killing themselves or whatever, they can't get to, they can't get any help. They just say, wait another 8 months. But that to me is as serious as having a broken leg. Because
worse because it can result in people taking their own lives.
And I've had those thoughts.
If they don't dedicate money to mental health, then we will slip back further, and that would be an outrage.
And I've got great admiration for him for coming out, as you say others have done, because I think every time someone talks about their experience, it just makes it a little bit easier for another, you know, another teenager who may be suffering in silence to think, well, perhaps it's not too bad. Perhaps I can speak to someone. Perhaps I can speak to a parent or a friend. And incidentally, just a message for any of you, if you see or think that any of your friends may be going through difficult challenges, talk to them. Because sometimes you'll regret not doing so. You know, if something awful happens, which it sometimes does, you will regret having not spoken to them. And there is no real downside in talking about it. And it just helps to normalise the whole thing and to enable people to seek help.
As you're planning on about drug legalisation for recreational people and medically, I was at the spring conference last year where I heard you speak about the notion about drug legalisation, about the, you know, the Liberal Democrats wanted a evidence-based change to the drug laws in the UK.
Yep.
For obviously many reasons, for you know, medically, for crime, or even tax. Do you think that legalising drugs in the UK is a benefit more than a hurt?
Okay, so I totally believe that we should start by legalising and regulating cannabis. And that's the Lib Dem official policy. I would decriminalise everything else, so you don't take people through the criminal justice system and lock them up in prison or do anything else, but help get them into treatment. First thing to say is that there is no evidence at all. When we were in the government, my former colleague, Norman Baker, as a Home Office Minister, commissioned a study, an international study, to look at, is there a relationship between the toughness of your drug laws and the level of usage in that society? In other words, does it work having tough drug laws? Do you reduce the use of drugs in society? The study showed there's no evidence at all. So first point is it doesn't work.
10-minute rule motion, Mr. Norman Lamb.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Speaker. So I beg to move that leave be given to bring in a bill to amend the Misuse of Drugs Act 1971 to provide for the lawful production, packaging, marketing, sale, purchase, possession, and consumption of herbal cannabis in specific circumstances by certain persons and for connected purposes. Mr. Speaker, it's long overdue that we call time on the so-called war on drugs, launched 45 years ago by the then President of the United States of America, Richard Nixon. In that time, billions of dollars every year go straight into the hands of organised crime. Governments around the world have been corrupted by the drugs trade. Thousands upon thousands of people have lost their lives in countries like Mexico and Colombia. Profits from the drugs trade have funded terrorism, as recognised by the United Nations Security Council, and thousands of our fellow citizens every year are criminalised for using drugs. This has been a catastrophic failure. There is an urgent and compelling case for a more rational approach. Thankfully, around the world, sense is breaking out. In the United States, Colorado, Alaska, Oregon, Washington and the District of Columbia have all legalized cannabis, introducing a regulated market. They've done the same thing in Uruguay. In Portugal, they have decriminalized drug use, a move which now has cross-party support from right to left. Instead, they take a health-based approach. Drug-related deaths and sexually transmitted diseases due to drug use have dramatically decreased as a result of that change. And now in Canada, the new Liberal government there has been elected on a manifesto which commits them to legislating for the legalisation of cannabis. My plea is that in this country, we should base our approach on evidence and on reducing harms rather than on fear and anxiety about public reaction. My sense is that the public are in many respects way ahead of the politicians on this subject. Now, my starting point, Madam Deputy Speaker, is that I'm instinctively hostile to drugs, legal and illegal. Tobacco kills about 100,000 people in our country every year. Alcohol causes untold damage to so many families, including its association with domestic violence, and it leads to violence on our streets. The most potent strains of cannabis also carry health risks, including psychosis and memory loss. But do we really think that we best protect people by leaving the supply of cannabis in the hands of organised crime? No criminal is interested in your welfare. They have no idea what they're buying when people choose to buy cannabis. They have no idea how potent the product is that they're buying. So-called skunk is widely available on the criminal market in every town and city across our country. Any idea that we can protect people by keeping it illegal is fanciful. Yeah. No one now believes that we can actually win the war on drugs. So public policy intended to protect people from harm actually achieves precisely the opposite. And we put billions of pounds every year into the pockets of organised crime. What a spectacularly stupid, self-defeating policy.
Second point is, it was that great President of the United States, Richard Nixon, who declared the war on drugs. And in my view, it has been a complete and catastrophic failure of international policy. I'll explain why. Prohibition was tried in the United States with alcohol. That was a great success, wasn't it? I mean, it led to extreme violence and the rise of gangster culture in many American cities. And it completely failed to stop people drinking alcohol. I mean, you know, it was just very stupid and had awful unintended consequences. So now we try it with, let's start with cannabis. We try that same approach that failed so miserably with alcohol with cannabis. What does it do? It gives billions of pounds every year to organised crime. We know that. You can't deny it. That's what happens with prohibition. Is that sensible to give billions on a plate to organised crime? It's very, very stupid in my view. The second point is that if you, as a person, as an individual, want to use cannabis, the only place you can buy it is from a criminal who probably has no interest in your welfare. So you have no idea often what you're buying, what the potency of it is. So when we set up an independent expert panel to look at the case for a legalised, regulated market, their conclusion was that in the interests of public health, we should introduce a regulated market for cannabis, not despite the health risks, in the interest of public health. Third point is that, incredibly, we criminalise still. I mean, you know, the police in many areas have relaxed their approach to cannabis, but we still manage every year to criminalise tens of thousands of people in our country. Even if it's a caution, that then blights your career. It has a negative impact on your career. Does that make sense as a society to criminalise someone for using a substance that we know, although it may have risks attached to it, I'll come on to that in a moment, we know overall is far less dangerous than alcohol or than tobacco. We know that tobacco kills about 100,000 people in our country. There's nothing much more dangerous than killing people. With alcohol, the scientific assessment is that it is the most dangerous drug in terms of harm caused. The violence attached to excessive alcohol use, the domestic violence, the violence on our streets. You don't see many people who are stoned out of their minds with cannabis rampaging down the street causing extreme violence. It does not happen. So the drug that causes most harm, we have legal and we get tax revenues from, and companies support political parties, companies that make the alcohol support political parties, and yet we criminalise other people for using a substance that's less dangerous. Where is the logic or sense in that? I don't see it, I'm afraid. I would encourage any of you who are interested in this and who are willing to challenge orthodoxy to read a brilliant book called Chasing the Scream by the journalist... Oh, God, that's scary. By the journalist Johan Hari, who was on The Independent. And he went off to America, to Mexico, and so forth. And he writes a brilliant account of the impact of prohibition, particularly in respect of cannabis. The final point I'd make is the extreme violence that is caused by maintaining the illegal market. So what he identifies that in the United States, where they do a sort of clampdown, a police clampdown on the supply of drugs to a particular community, they take out the suppliers from that community. What they then witnessed with some horror was that violence levels then increased in that community. So they asked, well, what's happening here? Of course, what's happening is that there's then a battle for the control of that market that's being vacated by the people taken out. And the only way that you can secure your market is through extreme violence. So it incentivizes violence within communities, and particularly poor black communities. And the authorities appear, particularly in the States, to focus on poor, low-income, deprived black communities because they don't fight back. The middle classes who use cannabis will fight back. They'll take a case right up to the Supreme Court. Poor black communities don't, so you just target them. Now, I find that pretty offensive. I should also just make the point that we could be raising tax revenues to go into education. We know that at the moment, the government's planning to cut education funding by 8% per student by 2020. Well, we could be raising some money from taxing this product rather than by criminalising it. So, thank you. Well, the sad thing is, David Cameron was a reformer. He was on the Home Affairs Select Committee before he became leader, and he signed up to a report which was calling for reform. So we know what his real beliefs are. He's a liberal on this, but then going into government, they became very fearful of the Daily Mail. It's depressing that the Daily Mail, I've witnessed it from the inside. I know it's true. It sometimes directs government policy because they're fearful of headlines that attack the government. Which is so stupid, but most politicians run a mile when you ask them to say something rational about drugs. And I have to say, when I came out and said it, that I supported legalisation, you sort of wait to see what the reaction's going to be. And actually, the reaction, you know, I had loads of letters and emails of support. I had, I think, two or three letters from constituents complaining, but that's it, and no adverse newspaper coverage at all. several newspapers supporting it. And actually, I think public opinion is ahead of politicians. And I'm trying, as I hope I've shown, not to be sort of making cheap party political points. I'll just make one. I don't think it's cheap, actually. I'm trying to get a debate in Parliament at the moment about reform of our drug laws. And I'm trying to get Labour MPs to support having a debate. Now, there's a guy called Paul Flynn, who's a left-wing Labour MP from Wales, and he's a very, very consistent supporter of reform. I think there's one other. No one else is willing to stick their heads above the parapet, and these are supposed to be progressives. So I despair at the timidity of politicians in confronting a complete failure of public policy. Just be brave, say it, and I think actually you might find that younger people who, not just younger people, but I think particularly younger people who believe in rational, evidence-based policy making would actually, you know, be supportive of what you do.
Of course. Is there any questions to what Norma said?
Yes.
So you know you said about there's a problem with people who can afford to pay for mental health treatment getting it. Would you not argue that you have a vast amount of people in the country who pay for a certain thing, i.e. education for university, who aren't getting supported by their universities in areas like mental health, because obviously the NHS isn't equipped to deal with mental health students. I'm not going to go into my entire history, but like I have first-person experience in this. And I was wondering, what do you think universities can do more that you, like, students pay for a product, they pay £9,000 a year for a product, and their education services cannot provide for them? Like, I'm not going to drag this university through the mud, but they do not have good services. And for the amount of money that I pay a year to not receive help from either the NHS nor the university, I was wondering what you thought universities can do to support students more.
Well, I think it's wholly unacceptable if this university doesn't. The umbrella body for universities in this country called University of the UK have now launched a sort of an initiative to improve the way universities deal with this issue. And they had a conference a couple of weeks ago which they asked me to speak at. So I welcome that move. And I made the point in what I said that it's very variable around the country, that there are some universities that now do it quite well, but there are other universities that are way behind. And I think it's a dereliction of their duty to look after and care for the students within their institution. And so I think those of us nationally should be challenging universities to step up to the plate. I think they're just stuck in a time warp. They're failing to recognize that now there should be a complete open recognition of this issue, a recognition that there's an alarming increase in prevalence amongst young people. We don't fully understand why, but we can see it happening, and to ensure that they get support. And what I want to see in universities is early support, and to use a bit of peer support as well. You know, students who've been through challenges are often the best people to provide support to others. And so universities should be working alongside students, alongside the Students' Union and others, to provide that early support, but also to ensure that when treatment is needed for a diagnosable mental health issue, that that's made available as well. So I think locally, you should be challenging university. I'd encourage you to do that through the Students' Union and through other means. Asked to meet with the Vice Chancellor, tell him or her. Oh, brilliant! Thank you. What a start. I'll pay you for that later. Tell him or her, the Vice Chancellor, that the former minister has said that they should be listening to you. But seriously, seek a meeting with the Vice Chancellor and put it to them that the level of support in this institution isn't good enough. Is that all right?
Thank you.
Okay. Next door, I think.
I was going to ask, why do you think that there is a discrepancy between sort of politicians coming out in support for legalisation when you said you came out that there was no backlash or anything like that. Why do you reckon there is that reluctance?
I think that they still fear. I think it's a combination of reasons. I mean, I talked to a couple of young Labour MPs who I thought would be sympathetic. And I know them, and I thought they'll be willing to sign up to my request for a debate. And they were just, I was amazed by how reactionary they were. They just said, no way, I can't understand you mad liberals with this obsession with legalisation. And that was the reaction that I got. And they're nice people, and I agree with them on lots of stuff. But on this issue, they were just very, I think, out of date and not looking at the evidence. There are others who quietly believe in what I'm saying, but still fear the consequences. And I remember there was a Scottish nationalist who came up to me after when I raised it first in Parliament, and he said, I totally agree with everything you said, but I'm not allowed to say it. That's pretty depressing. I think there's still that great timidity, the fear that the public will turn against you. It's interesting, there are a number of sort of big iconic issues where I think Parliament just doesn't represent people very effectively. I'm a very strong believer in assisted dying. I think it's quite an iconic liberal issue. So the question is, you know, if you're dying, if you suffer from a terminal illness and you're going through great pain, should it be you or the state that decides whether you can choose to opt out of that pain? At the moment, anyone who assists that person could face a murder charge. And even though the Director of Public Prosecutions has given guidance to say that if it's a mercy situation, they shouldn't be prosecuted, the family would have to wait months to know whether there was going to be a murder charge. So, you know, a Labour MP tabled a private members bill to introduce assisted dying for people in their last 6 months of life. And it was massively defeated in Parliament by people who, often for religious reasons, and I respect people of faith who take a different view, but amongst the public, there is massive support for it. And now on drug reform, there is evidence now that there is more support for reform than for status quo, but it's ignored in Parliament.
What changes do you think need to happen in Parliament in order for it to be more representative of the people then?
Well, it's a bit of an obsession with Liberals and Liberal Democrats, but I think there should be voting reform to introduce a proportional system. The reason I say that is that in the system we've got, it ends up with elections being determined, usually. I mean, we're in unusual times now with the situation with the Labour Party, but in usual times, elections turn on battles in a relatively small number of swing marginal seats. And so what happens is that both parties use focus groups and polling to determine what that middle strand of voters want and what messages will work with them. And so you get this awful sort of coalescing around a sort of mushy position to try and appeal to those swing voters. And no party will actually say what they believe. In a more proportional system, you would get some fragmentation of parties. The Labour Party, for example, would certainly, in my view, split into two, because there's a legitimate strand of opinion which should be represented in this country of, you know, socialist, a sort of socialist ideology. But there are very many people more centre-ground within the Labour Party who don't believe that. But at the moment are sort of in an uneasy marriage. So you would get some fragmentation, but you would have parties that could then come out and say what they believe, because they knew that there was a certain proportion of people in the country that would go out and vote for it, and would then get representation in Parliament. But this need to hit sort of 40% of the vote in any individual seat makes parties compromise horribly on what they really believe in.
One last question?
Yeah. Probably take a couple more.
I was wondering, regarding this, George Osborne now has a couple of jobs.
Is that all?
Yeah. I was just thinking, obviously, doing laws should be put in place so MPs can't have more than their one job, because I would have thought you need 50 hours a week to represent your constituency.
Yeah.
Because you think it's detrimental, because you think otherwise you could have MPs who don't have any time to actually be an MP.
Yeah.
It's ludicrous how that's even happened.
It is.
I hate to be conservative, but... you've sort of got to.
I think it's ludicrous taking on the editorship of a newspaper, daily newspaper, and a job that's earning him £600,000 a year, and his MP's role. But someone who used to work for him told me just yesterday evening that he didn't used to do much in his constituency anyway, so it probably won't be much different. And this is somebody who likes George, and personally he's quite an amiable sort of bloke, and he's a highly intelligent schemer, as it were. You know, for those people, I don't know what your views are, but for those people who have concerns about a hard Brexit, his position at the Evening Standard might be quite interesting in terms of presenting a different perspective to the route taken by Theresa May and the government. But on the direct question, should there be a restriction, a prohibition on other jobs? I don't ever understand how people can do another full-time job or a job that requires a big amount of time. I work on every day of the week, 7 days. It doesn't mean I work all day, 7 days a week, but I virtually never have a full day off doing my constituency work. When I was a minister, I was just working crazy hours. I wouldn't ban it. I think there should be, we've got now transparency so that you have to declare openly what you're earning from any other occupation. But I'll give you one example affecting me directly. Last year, I was asked by the West Midlands, the local authorities across the West Midlands, to chair a mental health commission. And they paid me for it. I chose to take half the rate that they offered me, but they did pay me for it, and I committed an enormous amount of time to it. Now, for me, the work that I did on that commission, I think we've achieved a good outcome from it, and I think it will make an impact in the West Midlands on the health and well-being of people in that region. But that was like a paid separate job, and I committed a lot of time to it. I think it's informed my work as an MP. Sometimes you have unintended consequences by having too many restrictions, and the last thing you want is sort of politicos who do nothing other than become, special advisors, workers in Parliament, then become MPs and have no experience of the outside world at all. So I think my hope would be that people who devote too much time to other careers get the punishment in the ballot box. The problem, going back to the previous question, is that if you're a Tory MP in a safe seat where your majority is 20,000, that people will just go and vote Tory irrespective of what they think of you. And it breeds a complacency as well. If you have a system that creates more competition where people can't take their position in Parliament for granted, then you get better politicians, I think, and people who are more attuned to meeting the needs of the electorate. So should we just very quickly go to the back?
Considering what you said about mental health reform and drug reform, how do you think the governments and kind of states in general should handle people that have committed a crime because of kind of a more serious drug addiction in their lives?
Really good question. And of course our prisons are full of people with addictions, or dealers, or people with mental ill health, or all combined. One of the things we're doing in the West Midlands, which I think is quite exciting, there's a sentencing option where if you've suffered, if you have an identifiable mental health issue when you first turn up at court after being charged, then there is a sentencing option to put someone onto a mental health treatment requirement, that's what it's called, which is a course of treatment to address what may well be the underlying cause of your offending behaviour. But it's almost never used. It's really stupid because it's available, but you need to coordinate the mental health trust to provide the treatment, the probation service, the courts, the police, and it just doesn't happen. So in the West Midlands, in three courts, we've now initiated a programme to make much greater use of the mental health treatment requirement. Now, if you can get people into treatment rather than sending them to prison or fining them, which just worsens their financial situation, then you may well be making the public safer, because if they're less likely to commit further offences, everyone benefits. And you give that person the chance of a better life. So I think you can, now you could apply the same approach to drug and alcohol issues. And the government is interested in sort of special courts where they have an expertise in, say, drug and alcohol issues, in mental health, and so on. I think we can be much more sophisticated in how we deal with people who commit offences where there's a clear underlying cause. Rather than just punishing people, address the underlying cause and everyone benefits. Is that all right? Am I going to get my train at 5:30?
Yes, you will. Right, let's put a round of applause for Norman.